evening, everyone. Welcome to the iLab. My name is Matthew Guidarelli. I'm one of the assistant directors here. Just by a quick show of hands, how many of you, is it your first time here? Okay, just a couple. Well, welcome. Well, I'm really excited for tonight's workshop. Understanding your audience, your customers, your users is such a critical component for your ventures and as entrepreneurs. Ian Fitzpatrick, Almighty's founder and CSO, is going to run us through skills and approaches to identifying anomalies, trends, commonalities within data sets, and also introduce this really cool platform called Polit that I think all of you will love. And so he's graciously given his time here. He's one of the coolest guys that I know. And so please join me in welcoming Ian Fitzpatrick.
My name is Ian Fitzpatrick. Like Matthew said, I'm chief strategy officer at a firm called Almighty here in Boston, actually just down the street here in Brighton. We've been around for about 10 years. I got my start in sort of an odd place. I started working for Mattel after the years when I was scavenging for free food at talks. I went to work for Mattel watching people play a game called Oregon Trail. Is anybody? It's like the one thing that connects me to like anybody who went to middle school in America ever. So I went and I sat in classrooms. This is a real job. And I thought it was amazing, too, and it was better than scavenging for free food. I would go and sit and watch classrooms full of kids play Oregon Trail and make notes about how we could make the game stickier, right? That's the word that they were using at the time. How do we make this game even more addictive for middle school students? It was an extraordinarily fun and time-intensive thing. If you're the sort of person who likes to sit in the corner and watch people do things, it's fascinating. I took that and turned that into a job in advertising. I'm going to date myself really quickly here. I worked on a campaign called Truth for a long time, which is like an anti-teen smoking campaign where we piled up body bags outside of tobacco headquarters, things of that nature. And my job there was, again, human insight. What is it that compels somebody to care about smoking cessation, for example? After 40 years of telling people it was bad for them and that not working, what might? And that was my job for a fair amount of time. Turned that into other ad work. I helped launch Mini Cooper in the US back in 2002. Spent a little bit of time helping Al Gore launch a thing called the Climate Project way back, also saying, how do we take what we learned about tobacco and try to apply that to what we can learn about, what we can do to spread awareness about global warming? Very, very different kinds of problems, and his approach involved a 7-hour keynote. Which is wildly different from populating tobacco lobbies with body bags. What I do now at Almighty is somewhat advertising, an awful lot of experience design. We build experiences for retail stores. I spend an inordinate amount of my time sitting in places like an L.L. Bean store watching people shop. And in one of the more lighthearted things that I do, watching women buy sports bras, which is an extraordinarily fascinating world. Once we get over the reason it's obviously extraordinarily interesting and we get past the part where I try to explain rationally to my wife that yes, I get paid for this and yes, it serves a purpose, what you realize is that there's a lot of friction in that experience. Namely, without getting way too far down a rabbit hole, that most of the people who sell sports bras, running bras to women are 21-year-old guys. And that no 21-year-old guy in the world wants to sell a woman a sports bra, and no woman wants to buy a sports bra from a 21-year-old guy. Now we'll get out of that rabbit hole. This is a talk that Matthew asked me to adapt. I did in Portland, Oregon in September at a conference called Planningness for advertising planners. These are people who spend their time trying to help figure out what is the large-scale brand strategy for a brand. They work in ad agencies, they work in communications firms. Some of them work as experienced designers in more traditional design firms. And what I was there to talk about was this notion of low-fidelity user insights and low-fidelity data mining. A little bit of quick context for that. When I say low-fidelity, I say that we're not searching for exact values. This is about finding something worth querying or learning more about. This isn't about how do we get exact values out of data sets. This isn't about finding truth. This is about asking better questions. I spend almost all of my time in my work helping clients ask better questions about their end users, right? So I talk a lot about this idea of curiosity, right? There's a whole lot of talk in the space around curiosity. And if you're going to do any sort of query around real customer insights, you have to start from this idea of being really curious. The problem is that curiosity, or a problem, is that curiosity, especially in market research, in advertising, in consumer research verticals, has become this really massive, sort of expensive, heavy, structured thing. It's typically done through either large-scale surveys, large-scale studies, or it's done through focus groups, both of which are really, really, really poor tools for getting to all manner of things about a user, namely the things they don't want to tell you, right? The delta between what somebody will tell you in a survey or in a focus group and what they actually do in solving a problem, using a product, trying to navigate a service is enormous. And I can and have talked at length about what that delta is and how to navigate it. What I'm more interested in, though, is how do we find the right questions to ask people? I would posit to you that most of the questions we ask people in focus groups are not questions that get to the interesting parts of these people's lives. They don't give us insight most of the time. In fact, they're designed to give us validation. Do you like my brand? Do you think about my brand? How awesome is my brand? Name five other brands you would use if you didn't use ours, right? And to get any sort of real meaning out of that, or to get somebody to say something that you weren't prepared to hear, is a real challenge. The other thing, and this is where I think it gets really interesting for those of you who are in a startup space, most data doesn't exist yet, at least not most data that's relevant to you. A true story, so we do a lot of work for New Balance and have for an awfully long time. We're actually sort of positioned equidistant from the iLab and New Balance, like sort of right in the middle of you. Their office is like an 8-story Eye of Sauron looking down in our offices someday. True story, I went to 2 meetings back to back one day. I remember the day well. In the first meeting that we were there to talk about the digital running experience, the client in the meeting said, absolutely nobody runs with their cell phone. And they knew that because whenever they run down the Charles River, they don't see anybody running with a cell phone. Now, all sorts of crazy selection bias in that, namely that the people who run on the Charles aren't exactly the prototypical American person, runner, or frankly, anything, but it's a great place to meet med students. And the meeting I had immediately after that, it was posited by a different client, same organization, that everybody runs with a cell phone now. Which is a little consequence unless, of course, you're trying to build apps for people, making investments in data, right? And the truth of the matter is that they had no idea whether people run with smartphones or not. Now, I'll cheat for you. 48% of runners, as of 2013, run the smartphone. They would have been smart to split the difference. But in fact, what that really meant is that they were both extraordinarily wrong. The problem is that data didn't exist. So we went looking, we got curious about this. We went to Runner's World, figured Runner's World would know. But no, Runner's World doesn't know. They know which brands I prefer. They know all the questions you would get out of a user study, a reader survey, the kind of thing that the readers fill out in the margins of the magazine every November, but they had no idea whether people ran with smartphones. Looked all over the place. MRI, which is a great trove of that sort of data, had nothing. WARC had nothing. So we decided, well, New Balance spends several million dollars with us every year to build things for runners. We should find out if they carry smartphones, right? We had to go and create that data. The challenge was that in their particular case, and they're not unique in this, right? It's something you'll run up against your entire life, is that the hubris of large organizations leads people to believe they don't need to invest in things that they already know. And clearly they knew that nobody and everybody runs with a cell phone, so that was all set. So we commissioned our own study to find out the answer. And what we found as we did that, right, is that it's really easy to get those numbers. You can go out and correctly sample an audience and find out whether people carry a smartphone. But that wasn't really what we were after. What we really wanted to do was to better understand what are the relationships between runners and a digital ecosystem and their lives, their relationship with all manner of devices, the way they track data, the way they store data, the way they train, how training plans and digital training plans and content influences purchases and all sorts of behaviors, right? So we designed and built our own fairly large study. I'll come back to that in a minute. In our space, in design and advertising, there tend to be two kinds of researchers. People self-select as either quantitative researchers, which means I really like the idea of insights, but I don't want to talk to people. Or I really like the idea of insights, and I'm not good at math. And what's funny is that groups, in fact, have built up around this idea that we have a qualitative research team and a quantitative research team. And at least with one organization I was doing some work with not that long ago, they operated in different buildings, which was sort of nutty to me. And increasingly, what I spend time talking about and what we've tried to drive home is this idea, right? That you need to be able to do qualitative research informed by numbers, that numbers should help us ask better questions. You should also be able to invert this, right, and do quantitative research informed by what you've learned in talking to people, and we'll talk about how that comes to bear. But for the most part, a lot of you guys are trying to build your own services, your own platforms, your own tools. And what I hope that this can be most valuable for in the next little bit is giving you guys simple ways to gather a little bit of data, not a ton of data, and instead of looking for what is truth or what is fact, that we look for what are better questions that we can ask, and how do we figure out who to ask things of, right? When you go to something like a focus group, has anybody here ever been to a professional focus group? Okay, wow, an extraordinary number of you. Has anybody ever been involved in the sourcing of people for a focus group? All right. It's a fascinating experience for those of you who haven't. There are companies who do this for a living. They maintain lists, massive lists on fairly low number of criteria from which you can say, I want people who have this kind of household income with this sort of education, who like to drive, which is always a funny one, or have a car, who live in this area, and I want to talk to 10 of them. What's funny is it becomes really hard as you do a lot of these, and I've spent way too much of my life in them, it becomes very difficult to know whether you're talking to somebody who fits a norm or somebody who's an outlier, somebody who's putting on a show, which by the way is almost all of them in my experience. It becomes hard to discern the normal and the typical from the atypical, right? So we need better ways to use data to do that. A quick note, nobody gets to opt out of math in this particular session, but I'm not going to ask hard math of anybody during any of the exercises. But the answer was 1 out of 180 at planning this. How many people in this room could, given enough time, calculate Pearson correlations between two variables in a large data set? Given an hour. Okay. So enough. More than in the ad business. Cool. No surprise there. I'm at the Harvard iLab. A quick note about mining. We don't dig and mine for finished products. Mining, in this case, what I'm going to talk about today, is almost never about getting the answer. Again, it's about finding better questions, right? The whole notion of mining is that we get ore, we get stuff that we get to use to make other things, not that we get answers. So don't expect that you'll ever find answers, especially in small data sets. And it's a problem that we have, and I'll talk you through how we handle that. So when we talk about mining, what do I talk about? Internally, I talk about looking for the interesting. Again, not truth. You're never going to find truth. If you want that, I'm sure there's a philosophy program at hand. And you're not going to find answers, right? You're going to find some probabilities, and you're going to find the interesting. What I mean by that is four things. Inevitably, when we go looking through data, we're looking for these four. The unanticipated at scale. So something we didn't see coming in a population or in a set of records. And the same thing we're talking about for human insights also applies to, for example, order data. Could be applied to all manner of records. But what are things that correlate or intersect at scale? Especially those that we didn't see coming. What are the most typical records? What does like a typical user look like? It's funny. Most organizations operate on average user, but they have no idea who their typical user is. It's an entirely different thing. If you go through a company like L.L. Bean, they'll tell you that the average customer is 54, which they are. They are white. That's a surprise to nobody in this room. They operate in the East Coast. They've bought a pair of khakis. They bought a tote bag. They can tell you all those things because those are the common traits of L.L. Bean customers. What they couldn't do or don't typically do is say, here is Matthew, and he is our most typical customer. We should talk to him because he fits the behavior of our typical customer. They look at the intersection of each of their most popular variables or their most popular behaviors and then try to find somebody who meets that. That's how focus groups are constructed. But very rarely is that person a typical user. The people we love are atypical users, right? And I'll talk a little bit about what that looks like. And then the ones that are my favorite are outsiders who look like insiders. So this, for example, would be somebody who by every account should carry a cell phone when they run. All their other behavior says this person is a cell phone carrier, but they don't. Because then you get to start with the really fun question, which is why, right? But you'll never be able to find those people and ask those kinds of questions and see those if you don't first start with the data. By the way, all this video that I'm showing is footage from CERN, if you're not familiar or if you didn't recognize it immediately. And I'll get to why that's important later. So where do we start looking for the interesting? I'll break out of this for a second and show you. I'll see if I can pull this up. This is a survey, the survey that we did. Let's see if I can zoom in on this. In 2012, around runners and digital. So 100 data points about the behavior of these runners. All these fields are required, so I can't zoom you through the whole thing, but I can send a link out if you'd like to see it, or I can post it afterwards. I'll post it on Twitter tonight, in fact. Asking people for 100 different data points about their running behavior. This covers what apps do you use, what tools do you use, how many miles a week do you run. Here's a whole list of brands that you might race in, whole list of brands you might train in. Here are behaviors you might do before buying a pair of shoes. Here are people you think are interesting thought shapers, thought leaders in the space. What is your perception of them? What the output, and this is a WooFoo form, the output of this is something like this. Let's see if I can zoom in here. Something like a massive Excel file that gets dumped out of WooFoo, right? And in it are, this is what you're looking at here, is 350 randomized records that I put in a public record set in a Google Doc, all right? So out of a couple thousand entries, here are 350 random ones. And you end up with a whole lot of information like this. And it's a fairly easy thing to go through and say, 61% of all of these people have run a 5K, right? And that's information that's actually fairly easy to access. You can get information on what percentage of runners run a 5K, how many people have run a 10K, how many wear Nikes, and all of that information. That's moderately interesting, but there's no reason to trust our sample data over the sample data of, for example, Runner's World or anybody else who's managed to aggregate this. So now that we've got all this data, what do we do with it? Where do we look for the interesting? So the first thing that we do, and we'll go through some exercises on this in a minute, is we've got all these data types. What age are you? We've got some very simple binary types. Are you male or are you female? Do you do this? Do you do that? Do you wear Nikes? No. Do you race in Sauconies? Yes. We also have lots of open-ended questions like, why would you change your running form? Or what's your relationship to this technology? Or tell us about a device that isn't a running device that you use and that you like or that you use every day. Some of that is really simple data. Again, Boolean binary data. Some of this is much more complex text-based data. And what we wanted to do, what we do and what we do now in all of this work, is we try to convert it to a common structure, and that common structure is almost always binary. right? Try to build as many yes-no questions as we can. Now, this allows you to get really interesting and really creative, and I'll show you what that means, but it also allows you to be dispassionate. It's really easy when you have a large data set to start looking through, scanning through, and coming to conclusions and saying, there's a lot of this going on, right? It's really easy to scan through. Hey, look, there's a whole lot of half marathon, even more than there is marathon. Boy, half marathon's pretty popular. People must run a lot of half marathons, right? It's really easy to begin to justify, by the way, all of your biases. When you do that, if you take the same data and you convert it to zeros and ones, boy, it gets really hard just to try to find answers, right? We don't want to find answers subjectively. We don't want to scroll through and come to conclusions. The thing we talk about a lot, I don't know how many of you have read Shunryu Suzuki's Zen Mind, Beginner's Mind. It's a phenomenal book, right? But this idea that in the mind of the expert, there are a few possibilities, in the mind of the beginner, there are many. It's something we talk about a lot at work, and you have to talk a lot about when you're doing research on users. We really like tools that allow us to assume a beginner's mind posture. So the idea of converting everything to zeros and ones, taking out any of our inherent biases and saying, let's see what the numbers tell us, is sort of interesting. Now, binary data seems flat. It seems like turning everything to zeros and ones is a rather dry way at looking at complex information. But what I would encourage you to do is actually view that as something that's very freeing. So finding out that somebody in the survey is an age of 13 allows you to actually look at them through a lot of interesting lenses. We just did another survey around sales data that didn't actually pull any users, but took sales records for a different shoe company nationally and began to look at correlation between where certain kinds of products were bought, right, and the behaviors and trends in those areas. And when you begin to break down data like somebody's being age 13, you can view them through lots of true-false statements. They are, in fact, under 15. They're not drivers. They're not allowed to drive yet. They were, in fact, born in the 90s. All of those things can be turned into yes or no statements that allow you to actually get very creative and begin to combine different binary sets, right? Somebody who is 13 and a female could reasonably be given a 1 as a teenage girl, for example, right? Also, this person clearly is not going to get any of my Buffy references, and I've decided I don't like them. This is where it gets really interesting, is we can begin to derive our own cases and associations. I'll show you this. So this, for somebody who, I've got to get away from my expense report. For somebody who we begin to be able to say, based on the state that a runner is in, let's assign them to regions, right? So we're able to say somebody in New York is in mid-Atlantic, right? The thing that they would never have begun to identify, but we can begin to break them, in this case, into regions that align with, in this case, New Balance's sales regions. Why is that valuable? Because it allows us to align the data we have with the way they structure their organization, right? But we can create even more interesting things. We have, there's a category in here, and it's going to be hard for me to find, called Shoe Zealot, or Brand Zealot, that is for people who run who run in more than 4 different brands. Nobody's going to identify as a shoe zealot, and you'd sound like an absolute idiot for putting "Are you a shoe zealot?" in a survey. But when you can begin to say if there's a 1 value in more than 4 of these categories, then create a positive a value of 1 for shoe zealot. It allows you to create your own category, a really interesting one, right? A little bit of a story. We found as we began to mine this data that there's a population. Now, only about 23% of runners only about 23% of running shoes are ever run in. I don't know if that number is surprising to you. Most people buy running shoes either as lifestyle shoes or because they really want to run and they're gonna, they swear. But most running shoes are never run in. There's an entire world of people who gear up. These people are all over Nike Plus. They're heavy Strava users or Runkeeper users. They buy really expensive shoes and they run 0 to 5 miles a week. All right. There's an enormous, now runners would call them posers, but there's an enormous group of, we'll call them aspirational runners. And they correlate immensely highly with people who are running to lose weight. There's a big behavior of people who are going to run to lose weight. They swear they are, and they bought everything, so they're almost there. And they match another behavior, which is that they are overwhelmingly 25 to 35 and overwhelmingly women. Right? Now, you'd have never found that if you were just going out and doing focus groups. You might have found that some were, but you'd have brought your own biases to them, right? Inevitably, a shoe company would look at that and say, well, that's not a serious runner. That's not who I'm targeting. And yet, we found it represents an enormous segment of the population. But what's even more interesting is when you can go in here and create a column that says, young female runner running to lose weight, you can see what else is interesting about her. What else is interesting about her is that fundamentally she lives in a very specific part of the country, South, right? And she reads a very few sources of information about running. So we know where to reach her, we know where she is, we know what she cares about, right? But this is data that nobody would have found in the aggregate, certainly not by using a focus group. And that's why turning all of these into zeros and ones allows us to recombine them into new fields that allow us to do something that they're trying to do at CERN, and it's the reason I'm using CERN here as the example, which is smashing data together. Right? What we want to do is we want to create an engine that allows us to smash things together like people running to lose weight and people from the South and see what it turns out. So to the point that almost any information can be converted into one or more binary data points, I think I've spoken to that. When you start to combine things like Alston zip code, Volvo owner, they can be described in any of these ways. This might be an urban vehicle owner, it might be an upscale European vehicle owner, it might be you might label them prick, right? What this does is it allows you, though, in combination to begin to develop archetypes and personas, even if they're only used as shorthand for the kinds of things you want to explore. This is hard. This is hard to get good at. But when you start playing around with your own data, you will. The challenge, though, is historically playing around with your own data isn't affordable. Right? The challenge historically has been that when you go through focus groups or when you have to generate all your questions up front because you're doing a heavily sampled 5,000 American survey, you don't get to go back and ask new questions based on the questions you already had. But we can do that now. Now, the other thing that we spend a lot of time doing is this. How do we bring outside data into the equation? Right? So a great story. We did when we were studying the behaviors of these shoe buyers, right, all over the country, and trying to say, okay, are skate shoes from this one brand selling in a place where skateboarding is big? Or why is this shoe spiking in this area but not in this area? We had this, this odd idea that we could combine our sales data with publicly available population density data. And what you found out, right, what this shoe brand found out, which they'd never thought about, is that they had certain SKUs, certain products that are light suburban shoes and other shoes that are urban shoes. But those delineations didn't break down. When you say urban shoes, by the way, right, in the shoe market, what you really mean historically is shoes for ethnic populations. But what they found out is that's not where the delineation was. That transcended lines of race and lines of income, in fact. There were shoes that were popular in suburban malls in Lake Forest, Illinois, and they were entirely different shoes than sold in Chicago. And they found that true in Highland Park, Texas, and Dallas, and they found that true in Newton and in Boston. Right? When you begin to be able to bring in outside data, you can start to say, how do we combine this with the things that are free to us that we don't have to ask? And it allows you to ask this question, which is to me the whole point of data mining. This is what I'm after all the time. What's the relationship between these two things? How do we smash together atoms from totally different elements to totally different bodies and say, I don't know that there's, I don't know, and again, this isn't looking for causation, I have no idea why one shoe is popular in Newton and another one is popular in Boston. That's for a pure qualitative discussion. Not looking for causation, but when I can begin to identify correlation between things that have no apparent relationship, this gets interesting. And all of these sorts of things, right? I love that this has a pointer. I'm very excited that I got a laser for this. All of these are the kinds of data that we're able to pull in from the outside. We have done, I'll tell you a really interesting one. Do you guys know what LoJacks are? Are you guys like old enough to know what a LoJack is? Like a device that goes in your car, and if your car is stolen, you can get your vehicle back. And I can tell you way too much about these boxes that go in your car and recover your vehicle. But what's really interesting is that forever and ever, the way that LoJacks were sold was based on the socioeconomic conditions of the community in which you owned your car. Right? If you owned your car in an economically depressed area, the push was your car is going to get stolen. But what we've come to learn in this country is that most car theft isn't two guys jacking your car for a joyride. Anybody guess what most car theft is for? Some pieces end up in a junk shop, and if you have a catalytic converter, I guarantee it will end up in a junk shop. Most cars that are stolen in the US are shipped overseas. They're shipped to Asia or Eastern Europe, and they're sold at a huge markup. If it's a crappy car, sorry if you have a crappy car, I have a crappy car. If you have a crappy car, it might end up for parts. But for the most part, they're going overseas, these Lexuses and BMWs. And they're being stolen by guys who up the ladder work for organized crime, for drug cartels, right? Because it's cash that can be used for all sorts of things. But part of this came to light was the massively strong correlation between vehicle theft and the distance of the theft occurrence from a major US port. Strongest correlation between the strongest correlation out of thousands of variables between vehicle theft had to do not with the socioeconomic conditions of the place where it was stolen. All right? It had to do with how quickly can I get this in a container and on a ship. When you look at the world through that lens, it changes the entire idea of what car theft is, right? And you can do that with almost all of this data, right? And this data exists in tons of places, right? So we're tapping into things like Freebase, especially, or data.gov all the time. But all of these sites operate with enormous troves of publicly accessible data. The Census Bureau actually has terrific, terrific data, and we've used it all the time. And the reason I bring this up is you got to get to a point where you can say, hey, I wonder how this A is related to B. So, first interactive piece of this. We'll just spend 5 minutes. So when I did this at Planning, it was a little easier because they had like these big round banquet tables that everybody was sitting at. So maybe just do it in your part of a row. What I thought would be interesting, and what I think it was a super fun activity there, was to, and I'll show you how this comes to life in a minute, was to find a group of people that you sit near and start to think through what questions might you ask. So we looked at things like, and these, a lot of these are real examples. I wonder how customer satisfaction with an automotive brand is related to X. Or I wonder how renewal registration data for museum memberships. By the way, if you're curious, I'll cheat that one. Weather and precipitation are massively tied to renewal information for museum memberships. I can explain another point why. But what I'm saying is that what I'd like you to do is get together with just two or three other people, pick one of these, and for 5 minutes or 3 minutes, let's see how many different kinds of data we might mash up with these pieces of information to create something new. And then I'll show you in a minute how we bring that to life. Cool? Oh, thank you. All right, we're going to try to share real quick because I do want to keep it moving for you guys.
So some of the things we thought about: retention rate for an online university, proximity to a community college, availability of public transportation, average income, the birth rate, percentage of the population that has a GED, price of advertising units on local TV.
Yep. Awesome. You got really close to one of the biggest ones for that, by the way. Yeah. glad somebody chose that one. Did you guys have anything?
Yeah. So we did click through on a diaper brand campaign.
Nice.
Felt right. And we went geography, age, gender, household income, vehicles owned, number of vehicles owned, device used when interacting with the campaign, education, and parents' careers.
And parents what?
Careers.
Parents' careers. I bet that's a really, really, really interesting one, even more than the demographic, the peer demographic ones. Who else had some good stuff? I'm not going to make everybody do it, but anybody else have anything they really liked?
The relationship between the last one, retention rate for an online university, and the presence of a mental health diagnosis.
I think that's fascinating. I'd have never thought of that. You guys had a lot going on. Did you guys do online university too? What's up with the online university?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we had internet speed, fast or slow, sports fandom, number of tweets to try and get at if these people are, you know, online. Then we had a couple things that related to the class itself, and I don't know if that kind of falls in the domain here, but the number of lessons in the class, the amount of homework required, things like that.
I think if you could find a way to quantify the amount of homework required, you'd find really interesting correlations there. The study I've seen around online university, by the way, underage mother birth rate in a community has enormous impact on retention rate for an online university. The number one reason people drop out of vocational schools, especially women, but men too, is childcare and the need to be able to care for their children and balance that with a desire to work and go to school. Anyhow, these are all interesting ones that people I know or I have worked on, but what I hope actually I get you thinking about is how do we index against these things? And the number one thing I would encourage you to remember is that when you start to think about how do we mash this up with data, how do we mash this up with our private data, it changes the way you capture data. For example, it's a perfectly innocuous mistake to ask people for their city and state. But when you realize that you're going to start mashing things up with outside data, you immediately move to asking for zip code. Right? Because it's really hard if you've asked for city and state or just state to be able to go back and get really accurate public data because everything is indexed on your five-digit zip code. Another reason why asking for certain kinds of data, dates in month, day, year form matters over a year because you can't, for example, very accurately index weather data on a year basis, but you can begin to do it really interestingly and granularly on a day-by-day basis, right? So what you want to begin to do when you design surveys, when you start asking questions, when you build the form that captures your sales data for your site, is make sure that it will work when indexed against other data sources so that you don't have to go through and by hand convert everything to try to make a match, right? So if we go back to the very first thing I talked about, and I'm going to show you where this pays off in a second, curiosity as presently constructed tends to be complicated and expensive, right? Again, the point I made a minute ago, it's crazy expensive to go back and ask people once you've asked them something. And it's crazy expensive to go back, find new things, and then query a larger set. If, however, we can lower the cost of asking the question in the first place, and we can make it really easy for you guys, without anybody who knows how to code, without anybody who knows a lot of math, to smash atoms together, right, then the cost of asking questions approaches zero, we can begin to do some really interesting things. By the way, what you're looking at here, what we've been looking at in the last several slides, is a video from some guys at a creative firm called Super Collider, who built their own glass particle accelerator in their workshop. Which is a novel thing to do, and I haven't the slightest idea why one would do it except to build their own particle accelerator, the narrative point being that sometimes doing something perfectly good by yourself is just as good as spending with a large firm. So when we did the runner study a couple years ago, cost us $524. $499 of that was the iPad that we randomly gave away to one of the people, several thousand people who answered. Beyond that, the WooFoo survey cost us for a month of hosting $25. We used a SQL Server database to parse everything, right? Some JavaScript, a little PHP to mash it all together. If we didn't give away the iPad, or we'd used a Google Doc, Google Survey, this would have been zero. From that, we've got several thousand data points about runners' behavior. We own that data, by the way. New Balance has to buy it from us, which isn't the point. And I don't, if this ends up on the web, I don't want to act like I'm holding it over their head. But the point is, we now own this data. We now have become one of the few places that has really interesting, unique data about the habits of American runners, which creates value for us, by the way. And now that value is created for next to no expense. Now, if you want to count the amount of time and the billable, the opportunity cost of our billable hours that went against it, I suppose that changes the equation. But my point being that for most of you guys, putting together a WooFoo survey and beginning to crunch the data shouldn't cost you anything. You know, I do a lot of mentoring work here, or have in the past years, and I get three questions inevitably. The first is, do you like my idea? The second is, do you think it will work? Those aren't always tied together. And the third is, how do we do really good research about our user? Because that's what I'm ostensibly there for. And the first thing I always ask is, have you gone out and spent any time with your users? Have you watched people? Have you queried people? And the point I would make is, this is something everybody in this room should be able to do, right? So when we can drop the cost of curiosity to zero, we're limited only by our ability to process that. And I'm going to show you what that looks like now after an awfully long slide intro buildup. This is a tool called Pollet. Pollet is open source. It is free. And this is the 350 rows of the digital runner study that we did, or that we pulled out for the public data set. So what this is a free JavaScript framework. I'm not making any money if you guys use it, that allows us to connect to a Google spreadsheet. So our work had all been done using a MySQL database, and you had to know a fair amount of SQL to pull it off, and you had to know a fair amount of JavaScript to replicate that. What we wanted was to basically create a tool that other people could use with no code background at all. So in this case, the data that it's pulling from is this. The data I showed you earlier, the ones and zeros, are being pulled into this particular. If you want to see it on your local machine, it's email.bealmighty.com/pollet, 2 L's, 2 T's. And what it does is it pulls the data in from the spreadsheet and begins to calculate correlations and find some interesting things for us. So if we want to look at a population like, let's find people who've purchased shoes online. Now, of the 350 random people we pulled, 60% of them have purchased shoes online. That's not very interesting, frankly. Again, you can find that top line information elsewhere. But let's see what else is interesting about them. The people who've purchased shoes online index high for racing marathons, right? They care about the drop of their shoe, that is the angle and the slant inside the shoe. They do price checks. They read reviews overwhelmingly. And what under-indexes at scale? Running to lose weight. People who are buying shoes online under-index on running to lose weight. Now that tells us all manner of things, or actually it doesn't tell us anything, but it gives us a really interesting question to ask them. Right? Now, who are, in this case, my most typical people? Well, my most typical person in this set is record number 90. The 90th row in my spreadsheet is the prototypical online shoe buyer. If I want to talk to people about who buy shoes online, this person matches the most common behaviors of this entire set. It's the most typical record. This person here, number 317, is the least typical online shoe buyer in the set. Yes. What do I mean by that? So I mean that a person who does these things, here are all their other behaviors. They run this many miles a week. They do this. They research this. They read this. This is the person who does the most things that most people who do this do. All right?
And does that also mean that they do this?
It does mean that they do this. The person who matches the most who doesn't is your top outlier. Number 98 has never bought a shoe online. But sure looks like he has. Now, that's not terribly interesting, but let me give you one that's much more interesting if I'm a brand or I'm one of you guys. So, as I scroll down, and this screen, I don't know if most of you can see it, will allow you to sort and see all the different things they do within different sets. If I go in here and say, race in Saucony. So, 17% race in Saucony. Now, by the way, this doesn't mean 17% of runners race in Saucony. It means 17% of the people in this data set raced in Saucony, right? This number up here matters only directionally, not factually. But an outlier. This person becomes really interesting if I'm a shoe brand. This is a person, or I'm a brand, if I'm looking for customers. This is a person who does everything the rest of my customers do but doesn't buy my product. That's really, really interesting. Because now I can sit down. If I say, you know what, I want to do a study of people who don't buy my products. I've got five. You can set it in the settings, by the way, for Paulette to deliver 20 records or five or two or whatever you want there. Here are the first five people I'm going to call in a study about people who aren't our users. Yes? I don't go through the same set. We as an organization don't go through the same set. Do we usually have hypothesis? Yes. But I would separate that. What I don't generally do is go and try to confirm my hypothesis, in part because this doesn't confirm or deny a hypothesis. This tells me what certain kinds of data in a set tell me. And I'm always going to want to confirm or deny a hypothesis based on an actual conversation. But this gives me a roadmap to who should I talk to prove or disprove a hypothesis. I'm almost never going in saying, I think this many people do this, right? Or that this correlates with that. Again, this only proves that there's a trend, that there's something there. I'm just looking for something interesting, not necessarily at this point to prove or disprove. And when we go in to do customer research, I tend to think it's a pretty dangerous thing to go in with hypotheses, because then you start looking to prove them, in my experience, or far too often I see us. Again, it changes the nature of the questions you ask. I'm looking for good questions, not answers to the questions I already had, which may or may not have been rooted in anything but my own selection bias. Yes?
So the question of getting outsiders to look like insiders.
Yes. How do we get that person into the survey? Well, this isn't a survey that was designed to find out if people wear Saucony. This was a survey of a couple thousand people who run and their digital behaviors, right? So we didn't go and say, are they Saucony customers or not? We're finding that these people aren't, and now I might go and have the opportunity to ask them, why not? Yes? Well, that goes back to sampling. Right? That goes back to how are you funneling people into your data set and how are you designing the questions such that they don't come with their own inherent biases, which is an entirely, I could do a talk on that for far too long. But typically, at a very high level, that goes back to how are you sourcing people and how do they match the parameters of the study you're trying to do? Did you oversample, for example, women of a certain age or men of a certain age or people in a certain region? There are models for that. And we typically use those when we're acquiring populations. Does that answer your question?
A little bit.
Okay. Well, we can talk. Yes. I'm not sure I agree with you that most people don't take surveys and say screw that. I think most people don't take blind surveys. I think if you call people on the phone at home when they're trying to spend a nice evening watching Gilmore Girls and ask them a question, Most of them are going to say, screw you. And I think if you send them a link on Facebook, most people are going to say, screw you. What we have found, and pardon me? Here's the way I love. This data was all made of, so we sourced this through running clubs. There's a massive population of running clubs all over the country, right? People who get together to run through a park on a Saturday. And they're spread out geographically. What we agreed to do is say any club that will bring this to its runners and any store that posts it, we will give them the data. You'd be amazed that people will participate if you give them the data back, right? Most people can't do a whole lot with it. It doesn't really create a competitive disadvantage to you. But if you give them the top line results and the raw data and say, hey, you, thanks for participating in this. If you want to go and do your own thing with this data, that's great. You'd be amazed how many people will help you out. You're not, the data in itself isn't, in most cases, for you guys or for what we're doing, what's valuable. It's the qualitative learnings that you get by going through the data and asking better questions, in my experience. Yes? And it depends on what you're asking them for. If you're going in saying, hey, I want data about you so I can market to you better, my response would be, screw you, I'm watching, not Gilmore Girls, but something good. And I dated myself really badly with that one, didn't I? I don't know what people watch these days. Anyway, but if you say, we're doing this to try to make a better product, a better experience, you'd be amazed how many people will help you if you're clear about, I'm trying to make this thing better. Help me understand what people need. We do sourcing all the time. And sometimes it's, to your point, walking up to people at a Starbucks in Harvard Square, which is the most, you'll never find greater selection bias, by the way, than Starbucks in Harvard Square. That is the definition of selection bias. But walking up to people, we do this all the time with wireframes, right? Walking up to people with wireframes and saying, show me how you would use this. Tell me what you think of this. Getting their reaction has enormous value. And people will help you if they think that your motives aren't to sell them more shit. If your motives are to sell them directly more shit, hire somebody. Well, so first of all, I think you would be shocked how many people fill out the thing for Dunkin' Donuts, right? I don't do it, but I think you'd be shocked by how many people do. The second point I would make, though, is that part of the reason you don't do that is it's such a passive way of asking a favor of you. Here, I spit out a piece of paper, do this shit so I can market to you better. Well, okay, thanks for putting forth lots of effort, Dunkin' Donuts, into trying to get to know me better. No, seriously, that's your perspective. If you walk up to somebody and say, I'm trying to build something better, and I could really use your help, I think you'd find that a great many people would help you because you're demonstrating an interest in them. And if you can tie it back to them, you're a runner and I want to help better things, I want to make better things for runners. Yeah, we're working for New Balance. We're getting paid. But we're trying to make something better. We didn't have to cast a huge net to get these numbers. But you have to be open about what you're doing, open about how it's going to be used. And I found massive success in offering to give back. You know, we do studies and surveys around all sorts of things we build. We have this monthly newsletter, a weekly newsletter we do. We just did a big study or survey around that. And we're going to publish next week in the survey the results. Give it back to people. Hey, we're going to use this to build a better version of this newsletter. But here, if you want to see what people want or what people like, here's what you all said. I think that trade-off is one that you'd be surprised how many people will make. There are any number of ways, by the way, to parse all this data, and I certainly wouldn't suggest that the only way to do lo-fi mining is to use, conveniently, the tool that I built and spent an hour talking you into. There are any number of others. But what I would say is that there's value in using this to begin to ask questions. And the way that I'm, the thing I get really excited about is the ability to the point I made earlier, combine these things very, very, very quickly. One of the things that blows my mind is people who think brands are experts. It's only like, it's a really small population. I don't think it would reflect here. But something like 13% of runners think brands are experts on running. Shoe brands are experts on running, which actually tells you an awful lot about the relationships they have, right? And it's interesting to study who thinks people are. I'll save you the effort of watching me do it. But when you go in and you say, who are the people who think brands are experts on running, overwhelmingly, they're people who don't run. Which actually tells you an awful lot. The other thing that we learned in doing this was that 80% of runners read customer reviews when making a running shoe purchase. 15% of runners surveyed write running shoe reviews. That means 15% of the population is massively influencing the purchase of 80%. But that's not what's really interesting. What's really interesting is who those 15% are. They're high mileage runners who've been running for over 15 years. They're overwhelmingly men, right? And they overwhelmingly read running blogs. So now if you wanted to change the entire perception of the marketplace, there's an opportunity to go in, talk to these guys, figure out how and when and where to reach these guys. By the way, in all this data, those people, those review writers, have told you an awful lot about what they do. You now have a lever that you could ostensibly pull to influence the perceptions of an entire set of market, or at least a group to seed your new products with. So I'm happy there's a tutorial I can send out a link to that shows how to use this. It's on GitHub. Paul, it is. So you're welcome to download it and play with it and adapt it. Now, the guys at Goodby Silverstein in San Francisco, it's a large ad firm, are using this agency-wide now for their qualitative research group, or we're beginning to, and are helping us build out a new, improved version. So there's a new version going up on GitHub next week. But I bring this up because if you've got a startup, if you've got a new organization, you're trying to do some customer polling and trying to figure out what to do beyond simply measuring the input, or you've got sales data and you want to mine it and say, what are the odd correlations going on here? You should be able to apply this to a Google spreadsheet with no real coding ability and begin to get some feedback. The other thing, by the way, is that I'm happy to say, and I'll answer some questions about this, and if we want to do a tutorial, I could even come down here one day and do a quick hands-on sort of tutorial with other people's data, which I've done. But the other point that I would make, is to reiterate not to focus on the numbers that come out of all of this, but instead to focus on this as a tool for asking better questions. So, long, rambling explanation, but I'd be more than happy to answer any questions about how we approach these things or how we begin to work it, if there are questions. Yes, sir.
I saw that the sample you took to get the data was only 300. How many people? You said 1,000?
There are several thousand. The sample that's public is 350 on a Google spreadsheet.
So how do you get, because 1,000 out of, let's say, even the United States is still a small size, how do you dictate what amount of surveys you get in result to go ahead and
How do you know if you have a reasonable sample size, a legitimate sample size? Okay, well, there's a lot of different tools that will give you representative sample sizes for depending on what you want to do. This tool, by the way, calculates when a population's sample size for any particular variable falls below an acceptable threshold. Typically, the surveys that we're doing are a couple thousand people. This particular one had, 2,800, 3,000 responses. Depending on the kind of thing you're looking for, again, I think it matters less for most of you. Most of you, if you could get a customer survey or a user survey that had 300 or 400 things and you're just trying to get some basic trends out of that, that's more than enough, right? Again, the point here isn't scientific truth. We don't care what the percentages are. What we care about is these behaviors intersect. And usually a couple hundred records will give you enough to begin to ask good questions. It's a question I get a lot when I'm mentoring down here is how many people do I have to survey? How many people do I have to talk to? If you're doing pure qualitative research, you don't need to talk to more than, and for a lot of the things I've seen, more than a dozen or two. if you're doing quantitative survey, I'd suggest you get a couple hundred people. Again, though, the amount of work that it takes, I promise you, to get a couple hundred people to respond to your survey, and even if it's not properly sampled, even posting on Facebook and having a few of your friends circulate the survey around gives you more information than you had before, which is just information you're using to ask questions, not identify truth, all right? And there's nothing scientifically invalid about using that to ask questions. Yes?
The effort expended to do something has to sort of match the size of the survey, I'm assuming. You're giving away a car, you can ask a million questions. Or if you're giving away a $5 gift certificate, maybe you can ask two. Is there a certain sort of level of fatigue? Is there like a sort of, this is a rule, never go above 30 questions or people are just going to say, I'm done?
Some of that depends on the distance that they have from you or from the subject of it, right? It's very hard to get people to answer a 100-question survey, and it's really easy to start piling in questions into a survey form, right? It's easy to go nuts in WooFoo until it tells you, hey, really, do you want 150 data points? That's a lot. The best surveys can get it done in one page. Let me get in and out in 5 minutes if you're just looking for some basic information. The more you can ask people a few questions and match it up with outside data, the higher your completion rate's going to be, right? But I don't have a hard and fast rule for how many questions you should ask. I think it has less to do with the prize you're giving away and more to do with the quality of the questions that you're asking and the depth of the response that you're seeking. It's really tempting to ask big open-ended questions, and there's room for those in these. Most of these are going to get turned into zeros and ones, all right? And there's tools for converting long text into zeros and ones, but you don't really want to go there if you don't have to. And people, when they see that it's going to take me 20 minutes, they're going to bolt. So give them 20 very simple yes, no, this, that questions, and find the ones that you can match up with outside data as are interesting questions. Yes.
You touched on this a little bit, but what kind of, you obviously have a reason to go and do these surveys, like go to start to dig into the data, some sort of bigger question that you're trying to answer, or do you not? You literally just go into this thinking, like, let's pull out something interesting.
Oh, I always have a question, right? I have questions on the top of my mind. There's a difference to the point earlier about having a question versus having a hypothesis.
Right. I'm sort of wondering if you do that out of
Well, the question usually starts the way that it started with New Balance or the way it started with the other shoe brand, which is, what's going on here? We asked a question and we got two different answers, or nobody could answer it for us. Nobody else seems to have the answer either, but having this would allow us to do this work. Inevitably, it comes from, we're trying to make a decision. Do we add these features? Do we bring this to market here? Well, we don't have any data that tells us what to do here. So let's go get it. And the whole point is, it should be a lot cheaper, faster, and easier to go get some data, turn it into better questions, and make a decision.
So it's sort of a bigger, we're trying to figure out what features to do in our next
right.
6 months of developing.
But it never starts like this. Boy, it sure would be nice to know more about people who live in mobile homes. I wonder what basketball is like. You know, no. Why do people like cricket? You know, like, no. It usually has much more to do with, we need to make a decision. And there's no information to make a decision, right? There's that classic line from, is it the guy from like Alta Vista or something, the CEO, who said, if we have facts, use facts. If not, go with my point of view. But you always want to get to a point where you have the data that lets you make those decisions.
And do you usually find yourself playing with the same set of data over a course of a long period and using it to inform lots of things?
Sure, because what'll happen is I'll wake up, I swear to God, like, this doesn't paint the richest picture of my life. I'll wake up in the middle of the night and say, you know what, I wonder, we've never dug into the relationship between these two things. I wonder if there's something here. And what you want is the ability, what you want is to ask enough data that you can smash variables together, right? And ask enough questions and get people to do it. But you want the ability to say, I wonder how these things are related. There's a weird thing going on here. I'll put it out of my mind. I'll come back to it. And 6 weeks later, I'll be sitting at my desk working on one thing, and I'll say, you know what? Why? I wonder if there's something that ties to hip bursitis or shin splints and this particular running brand. And when you find that there are certain running brands that don't market it but are tied to specific injuries, it's not to suggest that one causes the other. Sometimes it means that doctors recommend that brand for that. But you want to get to the answer of it. Why is this going on?
Well, one of your 15% of people said this is the right shoe for hip bursitis, and the other 80% went.
You're absolutely right. And that happens more often than you think. Yes, sir.
How does Paula actually work?
So, with code.
Right.
You like that answer? So how does Paulet actually work? What Paulet does is it takes, so there's a lot of different ways to answer that. I think you're asking more about the math behind it.
And like the analysis.
The analysis behind it. All right. So what it typically does is it says, for any population, give me what I call the inside population, the people for whom something is true, and the people for whom something is not true. Begin, so immediately figure out who's in and who's out. Then cross-index it against all the other variables in the set, right? So who is running to lose weight and wears ASICs? Who is running to lose weight and has changed their running form? And it creates for each one of those an index of the typical person who fits that condition. Then it calculates the correlation between every record in that set. I keep talking about it as if it's people, but it doesn't have to be people. They could be sales, they could be vehicles on a lot. It calculates the correlation between every record and that ideal to identify who is, how does each one of these in a binary sense, in a giant array that says this is record 38 and here is the prototypical record, what is their level of correlation to identify those things that most strongly and most weakly relate to that. Does that begin to give you an answer?
It's less elusive
now. Okay. I could go into lots of details about Pearson correlation and regression analysis, but everybody would have a reason to have to leave, like right now. Yeah. And it, yeah. And plus, I would fuck it up. What else? Any other questions? All right. If you have one, I'm happy to answer it offline. If anybody starts to download it and runs into a problem, my email's on GitHub. You can hit me on Twitter, and I'm happy to jump in and help you debug. But if this is something you'd like to use for your program, your startup, or anything else you're doing, I'm super into seeing what people do with it. And I'm super happy to come down. I'm down here a lot, and my work down the street, happy to come down and just work through with you how you can begin to put together a survey for the thing you're trying to build. So. Hey, thanks for being liberal and generous with your time tonight and enduring my self-aggrandizement. Thank you, guys.